Next, we'll speak with Dr. David Kibbe, President and CEO of Direct Trust and a senior advisor to the American Academy of Family Physicians, the largest primary care physician organization in the United States.
So good morning, David, and thank you very much for taking the time to be with us today.
Good morning, Mark. It's a pleasure to be here.
So at this point, the students are aware of Direct Trust and the role it plays in establishing trust across HISPs. But, of course, with health IT, adoption is always an issue. So where is Direct Trust in terms of adoption at this point?
Yeah, well, we've made a lot of progress, Mark, in the last year. Your students are, I'm sure, aware of Direct as a protocol and a set of specifications. They're probably not aware of the extent to which Direct service providers have been active in this, this sector of the industry. Direct Trust membership has grown from about 50 members this time last year to over 135 members. We now have 33 health ISPs or HISPs who are providing services to a range of customers and clients, including electronic health records. And of course, the electronic health records are providing Direct to their customers who are provider organizations and individuals in those organizations. We also have HIEs, some federal agencies now, and a growing number of personal health records who are involved. So right now, that network serves approximately 6,000 to 7,000 healthcare organizations. There are over 250,000 Direct addresses that have been provisioned for those parties in those organizations. And those numbers have been doubling every 3 months. So we think that by the beginning of 2015, there will be approximately 200 electronic health records, depending on Direct Trust accredited service providers, and approximately a million Direct addresses being supplied within the provider community nationwide.
Well, that's certainly impressive. In health IT, right up there with adoption is use cases, the purposes to which technology is used to improve care. You've told me about a very interesting example in hospitals at transitions of care where patients are leaving the hospital and going to a long-term care facility. Could you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, certainly. You know, a couple things to keep in mind is that we're clearly seeing a network effect occur. The hockey stick curve of adoption is growing very quickly, but we're also seeing that there's a long tail here in terms of use cases. The primary use case that's driving the adoption of Direct Exchange right now is, of course, stage two meaningful use. As hospitals and medical practices seek to meet the transitions of care and patient engagement objectives in stage two meaningful use, which require Direct Exchange. Hospitals are probably the most active now in terms of using Direct Exchange to send referral documents, in particular the transitions of care clinical summary, both to provider organizations on discharge of the patients or just before, but also to skilled nursing facilities. So we have a growing number of skilled nursing facilities and rehab centers that are, strictly speaking, not meaningful users, but they are endpoints for meaningful users and are starting to see the need for them to have Direct Exchange capabilities. I would add to that claims attachment is a growing use case, again, not related to meaningful use. And the federal agencies have referral needs to replace fax and e-fax and mail with Direct Exchange, and that's also growing quickly.
Another interesting example, I believe it was in Tennessee and Kentucky, is the use of Direct by health departments to collect very patient-specific data about those patients with sexually transmitted diseases. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, that's a really exciting grassroots use case, and we're seeing several like this around the country, in rural areas of the country. This involves clinics, public health clinics in two states, Kentucky and Tennessee, using Direct Exchange for patients who they refer to one another or see in common, and those are patients with STDs, as you mentioned. They are also involving an Army base, Fort Campbell, that has its own clinic. And I've just been contacted by the Department of Defense. We have a meeting next week to talk about how we can provide, how they can provide direct services at their installations within the coming months.
Well, so the use cases we've talked about so far are provider to provider. The students are familiar with view, download, and transmit, the VDT requirement of Meaningful Use 2. That would seem like a role for direct. What can you tell us about that?
The use of direct exchange by providers and patients to communicate protected health information is an enormous potential. We have about 15 companies in direct trust who are what I call next generation personal health records. These are personal health record companies like Healthy Circles that are contemplating or actually implementing now direct services for their customers, who are primarily patients and consumers, not providers. So that could grow very quickly, but it requires first that the provider-to-provider infrastructure be in place. I don't expect to see large-scale use of direct exchange in the provider, in the consumer space until 2015, because if you want to communicate with your provider using direct, which is a wonderful idea, is secure messaging with attachments, or you want devices to send direct messages to your provider organization, the provider organization has to be capable of receiving those messages and attachments first. And we're very much still in that building phase on the provider side.
You mentioned something that I hadn't really thought about before. Are the device manufacturers, the companies that are hoping to put devices into a patient's home so that the patients for chronic disease, for example, can be monitored more continuously, are they seeing direct as a technology they want to build into these devices?
Yes, without question. There's, one of the things that gives me real confidence that direct is a disruptive innovation is this effect you're starting to see where, of course, we're talking about SMIME over SMTP, email messages with attachments, but there's a lot of innovation occurring around the use of that very simple technology to replace interfaces of various kinds, including device-to-device interactions or device-to-server interactions and connections. That innovation is sort of quiet at this time. There's not a lot of noise around it, but there's significant interest on the part of device manufacturers and also the payers, for example, who believe that direct can be a last mile from the device or from the data center to some endpoint, which could be the provider's inbox.
Well, one final question. Of course, there are always challenges. It sounds like exciting times for direct and direct trust, but what do you see as the most significant challenges that have to be overcome in the next few years for direct to really achieve its potential?
You know, it always goes back to some payment or business rationale. Right now, the incentives for provider organizations to exchange information with one another easily and affordably using standards like direct is not strong. It's growing with the movement of ACOs, but I think we still have a hesitancy on the part of providers to move data when they're getting paid for duplicating care, for example. I also think that we have to overcome the stigma of patients asking providers, their providers, and the provider organizations for that information. There still is a hesitancy on the part of many institutions to make it easy for patients to get their information. Having the standard in place, of course, helps, but it doesn't motivate people. Standards are not motivators. Standards are enablers.
Well, David, I thank you again. I particularly thank you for your final comments, which just emphasize again something I've tried to get across in this course, which is that without the right incentives, all the technologies in the world won't change healthcare.
That's I would agree with that statement very strongly, Mark. thank you for the opportunity to speak with your audience, with your class. And if there are individuals who want to contact me or learn more about Direct Trust, our website is directtrust.org.